Be the Light in the Darkness, Suffolk Holocaust Memorial Day 2021 programme. Introduction and Welcome by Beverly Levy, Chair of Suffolk Liberal Jewish Community. Statement of Commitment by Mayor of Ipswich, Councillor Jan Parry. Mike Levy, Chair of Harwich Kindertransport Memorial and Learning Trust Limited. Pink Triangles by West Suffolk College. Suffolk Constabulary by Inspector Becky Kidd-Stanton. The Great Get Together by Northgate High School. Shared Act of Reflection and Commitment. Thank You by Gurmeet Singh Sually, Chair of Ipswich Faith and Community Forum. Beverly Levy, Chair of Suffolk Liberal Jewish Community, Be the Light in the Darkness.
Hello, welcome to this pre-recorded commemoration of Holocaust Memorial Day for the 27th of January 2021. The theme of this year's event is Be the Light in the Darkness, which, given the situation we have been through over the past 10 months, couldn't be more appropriate. Contributions have been made for this recording by Mike Levy, Researcher and Chair for the Harwich Kindertransport Memorial and Learning Trust, Inspector Rebecca Kidd-Stanton of the Suffolk Constabulary, Martin Simmons of Suffolk Refugee Support, students from Northgate School, coordinated by Sally Sampson, and Robin Hearn of West Suffolk College. Cad Taylor of BBC Radio Suffolk has also been involved. We shall finish with our Mayor, Jan Parry, reading the Statement of Commitment, and we shall also hear the Shared Act of Reflection. All these contributors will be reflecting on ways that our community, either now or historically, has responded to the challenge of refugees, asylum seekers, displaced persons, or people subject to hate crime. We thank everybody for working with Gurmeet Sually and Poona Atal of Ipswich Faith and Community Forum, who organised this recording. The HMD Trust was set up in the year 2000 to commemorate the loss of lives in World War II, when Nazis systematically murdered 6 million Jewish people and further millions for not fitting into the Aryan ideal, such as gay people, gypsies, people with mental or physical disabilities, communists, Jehovah's Witnesses, anarchists, resistance fighters, and so on. The date of the 27th of January is fixed, as this marks the anniversary of the liberation of the Nazi concentration and death camp Auschwitz-Birkenau. Throughout our country, HMD is marked by acknowledging the loss by genocide for many different communities. Locally in Suffolk, we now only have two Jewish people alive who are survivors of the Holocaust. One, Frank Bright, who survived Auschwitz, arriving in the UK in 1946, aged 18. And the other, Vernon Katz, who arrived in the UK in 1939, aged 12, on the Kindertransport. The difficulties in Frank's early life had a profound effect on him, and he now regularly talks to students at Northgate School, stressing the importance of tolerance and respect. Northgate School students take part in the Dora Love Award run by Essex University. Vernon has lived a life as a scholar and writer and a respected translator of the Upanishads. The local Jewish community is small, with the Suffolk Liberal Jewish community having only about 25 members, consisting of people well assimilated locally. Fortunately, there is another opportunity for Jewish people to remember their losses during the Holocaust, and this is called Yom HaShoah, and this takes place every year in April. Sadly, the message of the need for tolerance and acceptance and respect is as relevant today as it was immediately after World War II, as we are seeing the rise of far-right ideologies and nationalism as people experience hardship and isolation and look for scapegoats to blame for their difficulties, a situation similar to the rise of fascism in Germany before World War II. On that note, we welcome our speakers addressing the theme of Be the Light in the Darkness. Thank you to all. Thank you.
Statement of Commitment. Mayor of Ipswich, Councillor Jan Parry. We must make sure that future generations understand the cause of the Holocaust.
Following the Holocaust Task Force meeting in Stockholm in 2000, the Statement of Commitment for Holocaust Memorial Day, HMD, was created. We recognise that the Holocaust shook the foundations of modern civilization. Its unprecedented character and horror will always hold universal meaning. We believe the Holocaust must have a permanent place in our nation's collective memory. We honour the survivors still with us and reaffirm our shared goals of mutual understanding and justice. We must make sure that future generations understand the causes of the Holocaust and reflect upon its consequences. We vow to remember the victims of Nazi persecution and of all genocide. We value the sacrifices of those who have risked their lives to protect or rescue victims as a touchstone of the human capacity for good in the face of evil. We recognise that humanity is still scarred by the belief that race, religion, disability or sexuality make some people's lives worth less than others. Genocide, anti-Semitism, racism, xenophobia and discrimination still continue. We have a shared responsibility to fight these evils. We pledge to strengthen our efforts to promote education and research about the Holocaust and other genocide. We will do our utmost to make sure that the lessons of such events are fully learned. We will continue to encourage Holocaust remembrance by holding an annual Holocaust Memorial Day. We condemn the evils of prejudice, discrimination, and racism. We value a free, tolerant, and democratic society.
Mike Levy, Chair of Harwich Kindertransport Memorial Trust Limited. Most of the children who came went on to live successful and fulfilling lives.
Three coastal towns in the east of England played a key role in caring for the first arrivals of young Jewish refugees in the winter of 1938-39. The children, many hundreds of them, had escaped brutal persecution at the hands of the Nazis. They'd been sent to England as a place of safety by their desperate parents living in Berlin, Hamburg, Vienna, Cologne, Frankfurt, and other cities in the new German Reich created by Hitler and his murderous henchmen. The persecution of the German Jews had begun as soon as Hitler came to power in January 1933. Slowly and deliberately, the pace of persecution of the Jews grew until the night of the 9th and 10th of November 1938. It was on that cold winter's night that Hitler unleashed a well-organised mass attack on Jews and their property. 30,000 men were summarily arrested in their homes and packed off to concentration camps in Germany. Hundreds of synagogues from Berlin to Munich, Hamburg to Vienna were set alight and destroyed. Jewish shops were smashed and their goods looted. Nearly 100 Jews were beaten to death. Everywhere was heard the sound of ferocious mobs hunting their neighbours and the sound of smashing glass as windows of Jewish properties were broken. This was described by the Nazis, ironically, as Kristallnacht, the night of broken glass. Historians today prefer to call it the November pogroms. Kristallnacht galvanised the already fearful parents of Jewish children in Germany and Austria to send their children to safety. On the 21st of November 1938, the British Parliament was told that an unlimited number of Jewish children would be allowed to come to Britain, albeit temporarily, provided they were not to be a burden on the British taxpayer. Also, they were not allowed to come with their parents. They would come by train, then ship, and arrive at the port of Harwich. This programme became known as the Kindertransport, the children's transport. 10,000 children would arrive on the Kindertransports between December 1938 and August 1939. Only 11 days after this announcement in Parliament, the first group of Jewish children arrived on the first Kindertransport. Around 200 teenagers came from orphanages in Germany, were put in train carriages to Holland, crossed the sea from the Hook, and docked in Harwich at 6 a.m. at Parkston Quay. Some of the children were excited to be on this adventure, for many it had been their first sight of the sea. But few spoke English, and all were concerned for their parents and family, left behind in the increasingly hostile Nazi lands. Around 200 children came on that first Kindertransport. There were many more to come, including a huge transport of nearly 500 children from Vienna later in December. The big challenge for the organising committee was where to put them. An appeal on radio and in the press went out for foster parents, but the response was slow. There were nowhere near enough families willing to take them in. The organising committee in London decided to house the children as a temporary measure in places that had a surplus of beds. Hotels and B&B establishments were considered, but it was decided that a better idea was to place them in nearby holiday camps and boarding schools. The London committee, led by Helen Bentwich, a former councillor for the London County Council, negotiated with Warners, who ran that newly built holiday camp in Dovercourt, and Howden camps, later Pontins, at Pakefield near Lowestoft. These camps had the advantage of having hundreds of unused beds. This was the winter season when normally they would be closed. Added to this, the camps were a short distance from the arrival port in Harwich. Dovercourt was a success, albeit not without problems. The biggest problem was one that would also blight the Pakefield camp. 200 boys, only older boys, were sent to stay at the Pakefield camp and were warmly welcomed by the mayor and townsfolk of Lowestoft. At first all went well, but 2 weeks after the first arrivals from Germany, winds turned to the east and the coldest winter of the century set in. The camps built for summer had no heating in their chalets and rather rudimentary boilers in the dining rooms. The children and their carers froze in the sub-zero temperatures. Hot water bottles turned to solid ice, and everyone tried to huddle around the few heaters available. The camp at Pakefield was also hit by a flood of freezing cold seawater. Only a few days after it opened its gates, the camp had to be abandoned. Some of the boys there were sent to Dovercourt, which, though cold, was at least dry. But what to do with the kids in Pakefield? A solution was quickly found. St Felix School in Southwold. Being the school holidays, Christmas 1938, the girls there had of course gone home, which meant plenty of room for the boys. On 21st of December 1938, in the middle of a snowstorm, 200 boys, teenage refugees from Nazi Germany, arrived at St Felix School. What kind of reception did the boys find at the school? Let's hear from Margaret Williamson, who was then headmistress of the St. Felix Rescue Mission. The whole of Southwold and district seemed to want to help, and volunteers came to us from all over the country. Presents, showing much thought about the needs of the boys, poured in from our own girls and their parents. The reaction of the Jewish boys at the school was, it seems, universally positive. After 2 weeks of shivering in the bitter cold at Pakefield, they found a warm welcome, both literally and metaphorically, in Southwold. The school had good heating, comfortable beds, hearty food, including the unfamiliar kippers, and porridge, not universally admired. Lots of organised football matches, well-run English lessons, ping-pong, walks, and a chance to get to know the locals. There were trips to the cinema, a treat also enjoyed by the youngest refugees at Dovercourt, who were taken to see the new animated feature film Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. There were piano concerts, entertainers for New Year's Day and Christmas festivities. The boys were introduced to their first ever Christmas crackers, which one or two of them tried to open with a fork. Some of the boys, around 19 of them, were in fact practising Christians whose families had been deemed by the Nazis as non-Aryan because a grandparent had been Jewish. Miss Williamson and the others arranged for them a special service on Christmas Day with carols in German and a hearty rendition of Good King Wenceslas. For the more Orthodox Jewish boys, the school arranged a space where they could pray in Hebrew and were encouraged not to forget their proud heritage. Despite the sub-zero temperatures, the warm welcome given by the people of Southwold Lowestoft and Harwich was one that struck the Jewish refugee children as they made their new homes in this country. For most of them, it would be a lifelong stay. Many of them lost parents, brothers, sisters, grandparents, and their wider families to the savagery of the Holocaust. Most of the children who came went on to lead successful and fulfilling lives. Their first weeks in England showed them that even in the darkest times, kindness and the commitment of good people can change lives forever. Let the last words of my talk be from Margaret Williamson, that doughty headmistress of St Felix School. They can certainly resonate with our own troubled times. To us, all the fortnight must remain as most heartening experience of the lengths to which human goodwill can go and what it can accomplish. And that lovely vision can surely not fail of some fruition when set against the sombre background of our time. Margaret Williamson, Helen Bentwich, and so many forgotten names. The most heroic, the parents of the children who sent them away to safety. Their bitter farewells can hardly be imagined. Left behind to perish in the death camps of Auschwitz and Treblinka, the forest pits of Eastern Europe, their names are expunged forever. Yet they, those brave parents, were also a light in darkness.
The Pink Triangles, West Suffolk College. The Men with the Pink Triangle, the first published account of a gay survivor in Nazi camps.
Invaded the Netherlands in May 1940, they cracked down on the gay community. Willem reacted by joining the resistance. His unit's main task was to falsify identity papers for Dutch Jews to help them escape or hide in plain sight. He also began writing and publishing an illegal magazine, encouraging more Dutch people to join the resistance. On March the 27th, 1943, Willem's unit attacked the Amsterdam Registry building and set it on fire in an attempt to destroy records against which false identity papers could be checked. Thousands of files were destroyed. 5 days later, the unit was betrayed and arrested. In July, Willem and 11 others were executed. Frieda Bellinfante, a fellow member of the resistance and a member of the Netherlands underground gay community, survived the occupation. She described Arendus as the great hero who was most willing to give his life for the cause. Lesbians were not persecuted by the Nazis to the same extent, but many became involved in the resistance. Willem's final words were communicated by his lawyer. Let it be known that homosexuals are not cowards. Josef Korot was interned at the Sachsenhausen concentration camp in January 1940 after having served a 6-month sentence for homosexuality. In May 1940, Korot was transferred from Sachsenhausen to Flossenbürg concentration camp in Bavaria, where he remained until his liberation in 1945. He was the subject of The Men with the Pink Triangle, the first published account of a gay survivor of the Nazi camps. The author, Hans Neumann, who published under the pseudonym of Heinz Heger, conducted 15 interviews with Korot between 1965 and 1967 and wrote the book on the basis of these conversations. Between 1933 and 1945, an estimated 100,000 men were arrested for violating Nazi Germany's law against homosexuality, and of these, approximately 50,000 were sentenced to prison. An estimated 5,000 to 15,000 men were sent to concentration camps on similar charges, where an unknown number of them perished. Nazis, interested in finding a cure for homosexuality, began medical experiments on inmates. These experiments resulted in illness, mutilation, castration, and often death. There are no known statistics for the number of gay and bisexual men who died in the camps. Leading scholars estimate that the death rate was 65%. After the camps were liberated, many gay men were not set free, but sent to regular prisons, as even the Allies regarded them as beneath contempt. Josef Kohut kept the pink triangle and the strip of cloth with his prisoner number until his dying day in 1994.
I stood and waited. Still nothing happened for several minutes. The room was quite silent and I scarcely dared breathe, while he steadily wrote on. The only sound was the scratch of his pen. I became more and more nervous, though I recognised the softening up tactic. Quite suddenly he laid down his pen and stared at me with cold grey eyes. "You are a queer, a homosexual. Do you admit it?" "No, no, it's not true," I stammered, almost stunned by his accusation, which was the last thing I expected. I had only thought of some political affair, perhaps to do with the university. Now I suddenly found my well-kept secret was out. "Don't lie, you dirty queer," he shouted angrily. "I have clear proof. Look at this." He took a postcard-sized photo from his drawer. "Do you know him?" His long, hairy finger pointed at the picture. Of course I knew the photo. It was a snap someone had taken showing Fred and me with our arms in friendly fashion round each other's shoulders. "Yes, that's my student friend, Fred." "Indeed," he said calmly, yet unexpectedly quick. "You've done some filthy things together, don't you admit it?" His voice was contemptuous, cold and cutting. I just shook my head. I couldn't get a word out. It was as if a cord was tied around my neck. A whole world came tumbling down inside me, the world of friendship and love for Fred. Our plans for the future to stay faithful together and never to reveal our friendship to outsiders, all this seemed betrayed. I was trembling with agitation, not only because of the doctor's examination, but also because our friendship was now revealed. The doctor took the picture and turned it over. On it read, "To my friend Fred, in eternal love and deepest affection." I knew as soon as he showed me the photo that it had my vow of love on the other side. I had given it to Fred for Christmas 1938. It must have got into the wrong hands, I immediately thought. Perhaps his father had found it, though that seemed quite improbable, as he didn't bother much about his son. Or at least that was how it seemed. But now the photo was here on the table before me and the Gestapo man. "Is that your writing and your signature?" I nodded, tears rising to my eyes. "That's all then," he said jovially and content. "Sign here." He handed me a half-written sheet, which I signed with trembling hand. The letters swam in front of my eyes, my tears now flowing openly. The SS man who had brought me here was now back in the room again. "Take him away," said the doctor, giving the SS man a slip of paper and bending over his files again, not deeming me worthy of further attention.
From Poem for Cello and Orchestra, composed by Henriette busman for 7 years, the partner of Frida Belinfante, who was also a cellist as well as a conductor. As an elderly woman living in America, Frida was interviewed about her experiences in the war and afterwards. She concluded by saying, "I don't feel proud to be a human being. I think we are the evilest creatures that I ever met in general. I have met wonderful people, and that's the only thing that keeps me alive, that they are wonderful people. And there are people that I immediately feel are a friend. You know, I felt that way when you came in. It is not the people I know. The people I know and want to know, there are friends amongst them. And that is the only thing that keeps you alive, is that there is beauty in human beings too, but not enough. And there is something that I wish I had never learned about, and that is the evil that is possible, the cruelty that is possible. The rest of it is terrible. There is a universe, and we don't understand it, and I never will, but I am part of the universe. That is all I know."
Scarcely a word has been written on the fact that along with the millions whom Hitler had butchered on grounds of race, hundreds of thousands of people were sadistically tortured to death simply for having homosexual feelings. Scarcely anyone has publicised the fact that the mad list of Hitler and his gang was not directed just against the Jews but also against us homosexuals, in both cases leading to the final solution of seeking the total annihilation of these human beings. May they never be forgotten, these multitudes of dead, our anonymous, immortal martyrs.
Inspector Becky Kidd-Stanton, Suffolk Constabulary. We need to continue to work together to shine as many lights as we can within our community.
Thank you, Gurmeet, Puna, and to everyone from the Ipswich Faith and Community Forum for inviting us to be part of this special virtual Holocaust Memorial event. My name is Becky Kidd-Stanton, and I'm the Neighbourhood Partnership Inspector for South Suffolk. For this presentation, I would like to focus on how we continue to shine a light in the darkness created by hate crime. At last year's event, when the world was a very different place and we were able to meet together in person, I spoke about standing together against hate crime. The theme has continued throughout 2020, and we have worked closely with our partners at Suffolk County Council, the local authority, community safety teams in Suffolk, and with Norfolk and Suffolk Victim Care. These pictures were taken for National Hate Crime Awareness Week in October 2020, and they demonstrate our collective approach to tackle hate crime within our communities. We are often asked about what hate crime is. This short animation was commissioned for National Hate Crime Awareness Week, and it has been shared widely on social media. Quite simply, hate crime and hate incidents are acts of violence or hostility directed at people because of who they are. The protected characteristics that we record and monitor in Suffolk relate to race and nationality, sexual orientation, disability, religion or belief, and transgender identity. In order to help us tackle hate crime, it is really important to encourage victims to report the incident. We do understand that some people may not feel comfortable reporting to the police. You can also report via True Vision or Crime Stoppers. And support is available from Norfolk and Suffolk Victim Care, even if the victim has not reported the incident. We wanted to take this opportunity to recognise the hard work of the Suffolk Youth Parliament and some of our police cadets in helping to raise awareness about hate crime amongst young people. Please have a look at the videos that they have created. They can be found on the Source website. They have also created a hate crime survey for young people to help capture information and use it to help us understand how hate crime affects our young people. We understand that education is key to effecting real change in the future. Our young people are our future leaders. It is therefore important to acknowledge and recognise the contributions of young people in our communities. Alongside the Crime Stoppers campaign, we also launched the Suffolk Hope Awards during Hate Crime Awareness Week. As we all know, 2020 has been a very difficult and dark time for us all. These awards help us to look to the future, to our young people, and shine a light on their positive contributions to the community. The awards will be based on four categories. Each one represents aspects of individual school values. By promoting diversity, inclusivity, equality, respect, kindness, compassion, teamwork, and determination, we help to build stronger communities, and young people can be recognised for making a difference. The awards will be open to children aged 11 to 18 years in the age categories listed below. Every person nominated represents another light in our community, another light in the darkness. Every individual involved in Holocaust memorial events across the country represent more lights. Every person who is kind, who supports others, they represent even more lights. To make sure that the horrors of the Holocaust and other genocides never happen again, we need to continue to work together to shine as many lights as we can within our community. Thank you for taking the time to listen. If you would like to find out further information or get involved in our work to tackle hate crime in Suffolk, please follow hashtag NoHateInSuffolk. Or you could contact Charlotte Saunderson from Suffolk County Council or myself. I'd like to finish with a powerful quote from Mahatma Gandhi and encourage us all to make a difference and be the change you wish to see in the world. Thank you.
The Great Get Together, Northgate High School. I have a dream of a post-COVID world.
This is a beautiful day. It is a new day.
Hello and welcome to our Great Get Together Northgate Community Day for 2020. This one's going to be slightly different in that it'll extend over 2 weeks and it will be a virtual community day. So I hope lots of students in years 7, 8 and 9 will get involved and we'll have lots of involvement from our community groups. Our community day is partly in memory of the politician Jo Cox, who in her local community was trying to bring people together, but was murdered by a racist from her own community who objected to some of her views. If you look closely at the image, Jo Cox's quote, I think, is really important, that we are far more united and have far more in common than that which divides us. And that's a key message for our community day.
I dream of a better post-COVID world. And dreams are important, especially in these unprecedented times that we are living in at the moment. threatened by a virus for which there is yet no cure, and at the same time faced with a rise of ugly racism, xenophobia, and hate crime. But we don't just have to dream of a better world, we actually know what it can look like. We only need to read the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Its articles show us the foundations of a better world. Important as legal frameworks are, the first step to changing the world is looking at ourselves and admitting that we too have prejudices, we too are not free of racism or of transphobia or of other irrational fears. Changing our own attitudes will eventually change the world. That is my hope. That is my dream.
As you go into year 13, lots of you will turn 18. This is a great opportunity to use your voice to vote, both on a local and national level. But until then, and even after then, you may want to engage socially and politically in a way that is not just through voting. As you may have seen, due to the Black Lives Matter movement in the wake of the death of George Floyd, there have been widespread protests across both North America and the UK. You may have seen these protests in Ipswich, Felixstowe, and on a wider scale, London. It's been really, really great to see the change that can come about as a result of the actions of young people, and it just highlights the opportunity that we have in enacting change.
I have a dream that people will come together in spirit. I have a dream that people will appreciate everything they have. I have a dream that our lives will change for the better. I have a dream that society will help each other. I have a dream that life will be peaceful. I have a dream that everyone accepts each other no matter who they are. I have a dream that people will fight and find prosperity and peace. I have a dream that people will stay safe, stay alert, and stay strong.
Amara ekti shabna ache yelingo parnu darmu bayauna dishtibingi nibeshishi samwata shakalera guche pumchi yai.
I have a dream that everyone is going to live the life they want. Echo ena oniro, oti oli tha zisun ti zoi pou thelun. And not the life people say they deserve, just because of their skin color. Ki ochi ti zoi pou lene i alli odi aksizis, mono eksetias tou dermatos tou. I have a dream that future generations won't know anything about racism. Echo ena oniro, ότι οι μελλοντικές γενιές δεν θα ξέρουν τίποτα σχετικά με τον ρατσισμό. And that it will end once for all. Και ότι θα τελειώσει μια για πάντα. Finally, to those who don't think there's a problem. Τέλος, για αυτούς που νομίζουν ότι δεν υπάρχει πρόβλημα. My dream is that you will listen, understand and change so our world can be free. Το όνειρό μου είναι ότι θα ακούσετε, ότι θα καταλάβετε και ότι θα αλλάξετε, ώστε ο κόσμος μας να είναι ελεύθερος.
That you could say to us, what would it be?
If there's one thing, truth will prevail. Just stick to it. Don't listen to fakers. Learn as much as you can. Make use of your education. That's something I miss terribly. You see, I have no education whatever. I attended primary school for a year and a half, which was quite good, except the first year we did embroidery, which helped me with mending my socks later. I do have, of course, a photo of my class, but we didn't learn anything.
Greetings, Northgate School and community. I've loved looking through all the contributions in this year's Great Get Together campaign, and they're still coming in. Northgate is justifiably proud of the Dora Love human rights students who've been the driving force behind this 2020 event, which has been held online. And I feel that the place that it has online has a very special power of its own. You have reached out and you've succeeded in bringing so many of us together at a time when we've had to stay apart. Your theme is very well chosen and it shines through all the contributions, including very moving poems, films and artwork with people speaking from their hearts. We do all have dreams for a post-COVID world and we all want to use our experiences at this time and also in our past to make changes for the better. As Professor Schultz has said, we know the dangers and consequences of prejudice and hate. We remember Martin Luther King. We remember Joe Cox. We remember George Floyd. And changing our attitudes and being ready to listen to each other will change the world. We can define ourselves. We can decide not to allow division, prejudice, racism and inequality. We can learn from history and stand together. I hope that we can be better and, most important, do better in the post-COVID world. I would like to thank all of the students who've taken part, as well as the staff and everyone from the wider community. You have links with some amazing people. I recommend that we all share each and every piece with everyone we know.
I'm working on the PSHE and history curriculum in our school, and I'm working on the topic of Black Lives Matter and Black History, which I'm going to turn into a lesson for the Year 7s to educate them on equality.
We're working on feminism and equality for all genders and educating Year 7s and a younger audience on how to respect all genders.
We're working on LGBTQIA+ education in the curriculum and introducing different terminology and what you should say, what you shouldn't say, and how to respect people in certain situations, and also working on hate crimes and how they should be recorded and dealt with.
I'm working on introducing sign language to year sevens to make interacting with deaf people easy.
Hate crime against the LGBTQ community and what is and isn't harmful towards the LGBTQ community.
I'm doing a PowerPoint presentation and a lesson for year sevens, a PSHE lesson to help educate them on LGBTQ plus and gender identity and sexuality and just to educate them more and focus on the PSHE curriculum.
We're working on a PSHE lesson to teach your students about hidden disabilities and what you can do to help.
On entering Northgate High School, I pledge to respect people's opinions and beliefs.
To treat everyone equally and with equity, no matter their race, sex, gender, sexual orientation,
disability, age, appearance, religion or belief.
To encourage others to be the best they can possibly be and to show teamwork.
To show kindness to anyone who is struggling.
And to make sure that everyone feels that they belong.
To always have a positive mindset and display determination in everything I do.
To respect the opportunity I and others have for a good education.
And to use education to make positive changes that benefit others.
To think carefully about the language I use so that I will not offend other members of the school community.
To not be afraid to speak out about discrimination and to make a stand against prejudice.
To search for truth to educate others. To be the light in the times of darkness.
Shared act of reflection. We offer this joint act of commitment as we look to our shared future.
In a world scarred by the evils of war, racism, injustice, and poverty,
we offer this joint act of commitment
as we look to our shared future.
We commit ourselves as people of many faiths
to work together for the common good,
uniting to build a better society.
Grounded in values and ideals we share. Community.
Personal integrity. A sense of right and wrong.
Learning, wisdom and love of truth.
Care and compassion.
Justice and peace.
Respect for one another, for the earth and its creatures.
We commit ourselves, in a spirit of friendship and cooperation, to work together.
Alongside all who share our values and ideals.
To help bring about a better world, now
and for generations to come.
Thank you. Gurmeet Singh Sually, Ipswich Faith and Community Forum. We hope you have found this small contribution of value. Hello, my name is Gurmeet Singh Sually. I'm the chair of Ipswich Faith and Community Forum. My colleagues Poona Atwell, Beverly Levy and I, over the last few years, have had the privilege to plan and organise our local HMD programme. Partnered with local authorities, organisations and specialists in the Holocaust and other genocides, we've been able to put together programmes that highlight not only the history of the Holocaust, but also the contemporary lessons we must learn and act upon. Despite a globally difficult time and a tumultuous year, many individuals, both in front and behind the camera, have rallied together to produce a video programme to commemorate HMD 2021. I would like to take this opportunity to thank them all for their hard work and contributions to this project. There have been a number of new challenges and difficulties during the process of planning and organising this video. However, with a common focus in mind, we were able to achieve our goal. We hope you have found this small contribution of value. Thank you.